another venue on the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. This is the fifth leg of season two, and having already been to Barcelona, London, Baden and Dublin, today we touch down in Copenhagen. Welcome to PokerStars.com European Poker Tour, coming to you from Copenhagen in Denmark, and home this week to some of the world's finest poker players. But before we head off, I've got a quick riddle for you. What does a Frenchman, an Englishman, a Finn and a Swede all have in common? I'll tell you, they're all winners so far on this season's tour, and between them have won a staggering 1.3 million euros in prize money. Pretty impressive, I say, and more of a question than a riddle. Last year's tour was record-breaking, but this year's EPT has surpassed all expectations.
France's Jan Bublé in Barcelona. England's Mark Telcher in London. Finland's Patrick Antonius in Baden. And Sweden's Mats Gavita in Dublin. All winners in the second season of the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. In all, we've had 991 entrants in the first four events, and they've generated prize pools never before seen in European poker. So would Copenhagen prove as appealing a tournament as the previous four? Of course it would. 288 of the finest poker players the world has to offer have made the trip to Denmark to vie for the title and create a prize pool in excess of 1 million euros. Welcome to the European Poker Tour in Copenhagen. My name's Colin Murray and this is the Viking of the game himself, John Duthie. I mean, Copenhagen is in Vegas. Why such a popular event here?
I mean, it's simply because this is the main event in Scandinavia. It's pretty much the only televised event in Scandinavia. And poker in Scandinavia is just incredibly popular now. You know, everybody's playing.
And they all look the same, which is the strange thing.
Pretty much.
Yeah. 288 players in total have signed up here in Denmark. That means 144 on day one and 144 today on day two. If you missed day one, here's what happens.
As you might expect, the home country has been well represented here in Copenhagen. Great Danes Gus Hansen, Stig Tofting, and Jan Mulbeek all played in day one. Yes, that's international footballers Stig Tofting, once a Bolton in Denmark, and Jan Mulbeek, a member of the great Liverpool side of the late 80s and early 90s, a legend in my house. And we even had a referee in hand to keep the two in check. Yellow card for Duthie. Rob Holling has never won an FA Cup final, but he's won an EPT title. The EPT title, Season 1, Grand Final in Monte Carlo. And another former EPT winner played in Day 1, winner of the 2005 Vienna event, France's Pascal Perrault. And talking of champions, the 2003 World Series of Poker champ makes his second appearance in this tour as Chris Moneymaker. All great players, all out in Day 1. 94 poker maestros were eliminated on her first day. Aww, not Isabel. That leaves 50 to go through to the next stage. And top of the chip counts after day one were Bad Girl herself with 89,000 chips. Germany's Roy von der Locht, second highest with 64,000. And in third spot, England's Thomas Grundy, an online qualifier no less, with 62,000 chips. And today we effectively start again. A fresh set of players have arrived at Casino Copenhagen. 144 in all, split over 16 tables, including these nine at our first featured table. Well, let's meet them. Danny Shaw is in seat one. He's from Denmark. He's 18. He's a student. In seat two, looks tremendously like Danny Shaw, actually. It's Brandon Sampson from Canada. He's an ex-financial advisor. In seat three, James Campbell from the US of A. Another financial advisor, only 22 years old. Morten Jensen's in seat four from Denmark on home turf. He works as a dealer part-time and a poker pro. Joe Hashem is in seat five. He's the 2005 World Series of Poker champion, one of the biggest players in the world on our featured table. And beside him in seat six is Jez Bondo, who plays backgammon. A lot of backgammon players do very well in the poker scene at the moment. In seat seven is Ken Balagard, 32, runs his own poker magazine. It's Court Yeo in seat eight. He's from Boston. He's a comedian as well as a poker player. Doesn't look it just yet. And in seat nine, he's not the same size as a hobbit. It's Frode Fagerli from Norway. We're expecting him any time now.
Good luck, everybody. There's only two rules. When I raise, you have to fold. When I go all in, you have to fold. Otherwise, it'll be OK.
Joe Hesham then lays down the law at this stage. And John, a very good feature table. And the man has just talked to himself. Joe Hesham has a massive pedigree.
Oh, I mean, he was catapulted into fame in the poker world last year by winning the World Series of Poker and a mere $7 million.
Loser.
Great player.
Well, small blinds, or 25 chips and 50 chips just for the big blind. So this stage, of course, is very different than a final table as such. Players are looking to stay above the chip average throughout the whole room, and whether on the TV table or not, they will play maybe slightly tighter or slightly more aggressive, depending on the style of multi-table.
Yeah, it's always interesting. This is what is interesting about joining these tables early on in a tournament, is that you start to see how people actually get to the final table and the route that they take there. Obviously, you know, Joe Hesham is winning here at the moment, and he's picked up top pair, so he's in good shape. So, Shu checks, Sampson checks, and Joe puts in a bet here of
50 chips.
A mere 50.
And as you heard him say, they must now all fold. Let's see what Danny Shu does in the small blind.
Well, he's calling with the third highest pair.
Not going to be much good to him.
No, he wanted to make two pair there. It's interesting. Joe may think he's being trapped here, I don't know. Nope, there he goes.
The bet that comes in is a 500. That brings the pot total to 750. And that means Danny Shu has to fold out, so the biggest player wins the first pot of our day, of our feature table. But we know all about this man, so let's find out about Denmark's very own 18-year-old student, Danny Shu.
My name is Danny Skov, and I'm 18 years old and from Denmark. I play computer games, and when I got time for it, I do a little skateboarding. I play a lot of online poker. I signed up at a poker site at the internet and got $25 for free. And then I played a small satellite to a bigger tournament, which I won. And then I played in the big tournament, won that one too. So I got here for nothing. I like to play a lot of different styles. So it depends on the other players at the table and how many chips I got.
Don't forget your education, son. You can't be gallivanting around Europe playing poker all the time in the EPT. He's got to be thinking about trigonometry. There's a fold, John.
Yeah, well, you know, a lot of players will fold hands like that early on in a tournament. They're just waiting for big hands. You know, you've got a long day ahead of you.
Well, ace-king for Danny Shu, who we've just learnt a bit about. So he fancies this hand, certainly in the position he's in as well.
Danny now raised to 200.
An extra 150.
For
Joe in the big blind, will he call it? And he does call it with a pair of threes, pocket threes, which, as you can see, it's a toss of a coin. Let's see what the flop does.
And the flop is deuce.
Well, nobody hits anything at this stage, which means it's Joe, the World Series of Poker champion, in pole possession, but a lot of scare cards out there when all you've got is pocket threes. So let's see how the youngster from Denmark plays this.
Joe bets 300.
He can win this without actually having hit anything if he raises.
Then he calls.
He only calls.
I think Joe knows. I think Joe's pretty certain he might be winning here.
Well, that's interesting indeed, because obviously any 5, 6, 9 or 10 in the hand of Danny Shu wins the hand for him. So let's see if he has the kahunas to take on the World Series of Poker champion. Big
nice
bet.
Yeah, it's a nice bet from Joe there, 600, because he's, you know, he thinks he's still winning, and indeed he is.
There you go, very good pot for Hesham.
I like this, boys. Keep it up.
Well, let's go out to Natalie and find out exactly what's happening on the outer tables.
Well, of course, the TV table isn't the only one here at Casino Copenhagen. There are 16 more, comprising another 136 hopeful poker players. So let's go and see who we can find.
Well, Natalie, what is it with poker and ex-football players? Thomas Brolin, who represented Sweden 47 times in his footy career and buried England on one occasion, now represents him in the poker tables. And he wasn't the only Swede that made the trip to Copenhagen. Christer Johansson, second in the Barcelona EPT event earlier this season, is here along with his wife, Brigitta. And Mrs. Johansson is also in the tournament. She played yesterday and is through to tomorrow's play. Indeed, the first sex are well represented here in Copenhagen. It includes America's Sharon Goldman, who made the long trip across the Atlantic. Sweden's Cecilia Nordenstam. Always a pleasure to have her here in the European Poker Tour. That's Kirsty Greeny and Veronica Larsen. They're from Norway. And from the home nation, Denmark's Anina Gundersen, an online qualifier. And this is Pernilla Ravin talking to Ram Faswani here. Ram, you're married, son. Is Marcel Lusk married? I'm not sure, but he was here along with Dutch countrymen and reigning EPT champion of Copenhagen, Noah Boakin. So what of Thomas Brolin? What did he do? Well, he didn't last too long. Knocked out by Italy's Luca Pagano. 1-0 Italy. Thank you very, very much for this man to grace us with his presence. Frode Fagerly here.
Thank you for coming.
Good dog, good dog.
And being greeted in 17 different languages.
Oh, thank you, they got me one. Yeah. Appreciate it.
It's interesting, you can turn up quite late at an event when you've got 10,000 chips in front of you and the blinds are very small.
Big tables.
Yeah, if you remember Patrick Antonius in Baden, I think he arrived about 3 hours late and ended up winning it. You know, it can be done.
Footballers and poker, eh? And loads of sports stars, of course. Mark Williams, a snooker player, a very handy poker player. Stephen Hendry plays as well. Jimmy White plays. But I'd say Mark Williams, the most accomplished British sportsman when it comes to poker.
No, Mark's he's a good player.
Joe Hashem then's making all the running at our TV table. Another raise from him, pre-flop. King 4 suited and Fagerly straight into the action, calling it with his suited connector. So anyone's flop, really.
I mean, I prefer the 8-9 suited personally, but Joe's playing, you know, aggressively, starting out, raising, find out where he is. Oh, he seems to be connecting too.
Well, interestingly, of course, Fagerly opens up an open-ended straight. Joe Hashem's got the top pair with the king, and it's Fagerly who bets into it.
Joe raising to 700.
Joe's got the top pair and a fairly intelligent raise, although absolutely nothing in way of kickers. Fagerly hits a pair. The same situation, though, of course, top pairs with Hashem.
Joe's betting 1,200.
That's a big call to make, isn't it?
It is a big call. I mean, Joe's playing this hand really nicely. He's checked, then you know, raised him on the flop. He knows he's winning now.
Well, he's not anymore because Fagerly on the river. Well, there you go. You got to speculate, to accumulate, and he's been sucked into the straight here. Fagerly makes the bet of 2,500, and Big Joe's going to know he's been caught here. Fagerly's been fishing, and he's caught a big one in the river.
Yeah, Joe unfortunate to catch the bottom end of the straight there too, you know, with the 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 against the 8, 9.
Well, Fagerly turned up late, straight into the action. Big win.
Check raise, and pulls 400 fold. No wonder you were late.
Joe played that hand very well. Frode Fagerly didn't, but he wins the pot.
Well, it wasn't that bad. I mean, I'd have probably called on the turn. I've picked up a pair with my open-ended straight draw, so it's not such a bad play. He's hit his flop, really, let's face it. But Joe was unlucky. Oh, here we go. Now he's got a real hand. Let's see how he plays this. Okay, so.
Not a big raise, but he's got a lot of players in front of him. And you want to keep as many in this hand as possible.
Exactly, three times the big blind. So, Fagerly's called with ace 10. Not a good call. You don't want to be calling with ace 10 in the early stages of a tournament because everybody's playing ace king, ace queen.
At the same time, he's calling with Hashem's chips.
I'll be honest with you, Colin. I'd actually rather have 5-8 suited than ace 10, personally.
Why is that?
Because everybody's playing ace 10 and ace queen and ace jack, like I just said.
You'd rather have something that's unreadable.
Yeah, you can get away from 5-8 very easily.
Okay, well, this is the situation. Hashim bets 1,000. He bets out. He is in the leads at the moment.
He'll probably get called by the nines, I think.
He should get called by the other overpair, but at this stage, I mean, it's quite simple. Morten Jensen's walking into a monster unless he has his nine. You're right, he obviously is going to call that.
He's a good player, Morten. I mean, he may... Yeah, he's certainly going to just call, yeah. He's desperate to hit his nine here. Let's see how big the bet is on the... you see, Hakan might be worried about the diamond there, so he's checked it.
Well, he could be as well. Jensen will hit a flush if he hits another diamond. That's exactly what he's got with that runner. Look at that.
Ooh, that's cruel.
That's a board of shame for Joe Hashim. It doesn't matter how many rings or bracelets you have on you. This is poker, as simple as that. Morten Jensen takes a big pot.
How come it seems like I'm playing every hand?
Because you have.
I am, aren't I?
He's not playing them because he's a champ. He's playing them because he's one of the best players in the world, and he's getting the cards. It's all going to the TV table. We're in Copenhagen. We're back soon. Welcome back to Copenhagen and the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. The tournament is in its second day, but before we go any further, let's refresh our memories on how to play. Texas Hold'em's the game in these parts, so simple, anyone can play. On each hand, one player's on the button, which means they're nominated dealer for that round. The button will then move clockwise to the next player after each hand. These two players to the left of the button then have to pay the small blind and the big blind. These bets are called blinds because the players have to kick off the betting blind of seeing their cards. Then everyone gets dealt two cards known as the hole cards. Now, for the first rounds of betting, based on just these two hole cards, players can decide to fold if they don't fancy it.
Casper, fold.
They can call, which means matching the last bet.
Call 50.
Or raise, depending on whether or not they like their hand.
Hoist and raise at 300.
Once all the betting is level, the flop is dealt. The flop is very simply three community cards dealt face up in the middle of the table. Based on these three cards, another round of betting begins, starting with the active player immediately to the left of the button. And then we'll see another community card. It's the fourth card out of five, and it's known as the turn. Yet again, the chips come into play. Once this turn card is dealt, we have to have one other round of betting. It's the third round of betting at this stage, and that precedes the fifth and final community card, which is known as the deadly river. The river card will be the final card that comes into play, but that doesn't mean it's the end of the betting. One more chance to get those chips in. Final round. The aim is to make the best five cards from the two hole cards in your hand and the five in the table. In this case, Greg Raymer picked up a five in the river to complete his full house, which beats two pair any day of the week. There you go, something brand new for you now. As you can see in the corner of your screen, we're going to sweat with Joe Hashim. That basically means the only cards we're going to see in this hand are Joe's cards. We're going to play it like him, and John's going to talk us through the strategy of how he plays it. So, for example, Jez Bondo has made a raise of 150 on top of the 50 chip blind. So we're not going to see what he has. We're going to see how Joe plays it. He may just fold out. He may not. Let's find out.
OK, so we got a caller. So Bondo's raised three times the big blind, 150. There's been one call. So Joe's trying to put them on a hand. He's trying to work out what they have got.
Well, we see Hashim's cards. A very good hand to sweat with Joe. He's got ace, queen. Let's take a look at the flop. James Campbell's in there as well. Talk us through what's just happened there, John.
OK, so Joe's hit the top pair. OK, so he's checked to see if he can get a read on his opponent, see whether his opponent's got aces or kings. So he's bet 500.
Well, that is exactly the problem, of course. Pocket pairs, pocket aces, pocket kings beat him. But apart from that, he's in a very strong position. He's got ace, queen in this hand. He's hit the top pair.
OK, now the other guy's just called, so he's probably going to put him on a flush draw. He could have 3-5, I suppose it's unlikely, but he's called.
It's unlikely he would have went with a pre-flop raise with that hand. So he could be on a flush draw. He could be on a queen with a lower kicker.
Okay, so Joe's just called as well. Okay, now he's got two pair. Now he's in a great position. A 3-5 would be beating him, but you know, he might be a little bit scared of trip aces, but highly unlikely. Now he's really trap checking.
And of course, pocket kings means absolutely nothing now. So if he was going up against a higher pocket pair, than the money he had when he had top pair on the flop, it means nothing.
Okay, so now Bondo's bet 1,000. The other player folded.
Show is raising to 2,500.
Oh, this is a great play. Now, okay, so Bondo presumably may have ace king, and Joe's trying to work it out.
Yes, call.
Okay, so he's just called. It's a bit tricky, this. Now, if he's got pocket aces, Joe's thinking, I could be in trouble.
Well, ace king, you'd be thinking, I've got the two pair if he was an ace king there. I've got the two pair with my king kicker making up my best five card hand.
Yeah, exactly. So he's more than likely he's got ace. Bondo's got ace king because he's had to call on the end.
Aces and queens.
And he called very quickly. I suspect he had ace king. Oh, ace jack. That's interesting. It was, you know, it had to have an ace.
That was the main thing. He had to have an ace in his hand. Joe called that. John called it here. So he just had a nice sweat with Joe Hashem. We'll do that again at some stage. Really enjoy that. The best way to learn if you're watching on the television, get a bit of paper, cover up the corner of your TV screen. Don't even see the cards we're talking about. Turn the sound down. John and I talk rubbish and try and guess what cards are actually in the hands of these players. That's how you learn. That's how I became the great player I am today. Hashem again, cards hitting him in the face. King, queen.
Yep, no, nice starting hand for Joe again. He's raised it up. And he's got called with ace five. Now, yeah, I'd be scared too. I mean, I'm not sure. Ace five, I wouldn't want to call with this hand. Well, you see, if you hit your ace, he doesn't know that Joe hasn't got an ace. So Joe will probably represent the ace now by betting. See how much he bets. Okay, he's bet 350. Okay, so
Frodo makes the call. Yes,
yeah,
the problem is you've no kicker. You've nothing there. You've got a five in your hand with that ace. It looks like a clever call from Fagerly at the moment, because he's hit his ace and he's not going up against it. But Hashem was the one that raised pre-flop. You've got to put him in a big hand. If you get caught with someone with ace anything above a five, you're in trouble.
Yeah, well, you know, the thing is that Fagerly is pretty certain he's winning now because Joe checked on the turn, so Fagerly's bet to 500. There's no way... Joe's not going to call with king. He can't call with king high, surely.
Joe calls. Showdown.
I think he's... To be honest, I think Joe's called that just to see what this guy's playing with.
Well, they've been up against each other so many times. Fagerly's made a call on a pre-flop raise there on an ace five. And what we're trying to say there in that situation is, if you go up with someone who's got an ace jack, they're going to beat you in the kicker. An ace queen, they're going to beat you in the kicker. Well, anything above an ace five is going to beat you. Just because you have the A in your hand doesn't mean you're A-OK pre-flop.
No, it does not. Sure does not.
Now that's a better hand. James Campbell from the USA with ace king suited.
Okay, so he's gone four times the big blind. He's made it 400.
Oh! And a re-raise. Another 1,000 on top of that from Joe Hashem, who's hit ace. Unbelievable. You bring this World Series of Poker champion to our table, he's hitting card after card after card.
Well, I think he's going to get called here at least.
James Campbell from the USA is completely dominated.
So let's see what happens here.
He need two kings in the flop. That's what he's going to need, two kings before the end of the day.
Oh, wow.
And he's hit one of them, and it could be bad news for him because he's going to bet into this. Well, he thinks he's trap checking. He thinks he's trap checking.
No, of course he does.
Well, we know he's not because Hashem's got the bullets.
No, he's just trying to work out what to do, how big a raise to put in here. Probably make it 6,000, I would have thought.
And before the sun goes down in this hand, he's going to need another king to get out of jail.
He may make it 5,000. I think he's going to get called.
He has to get called.
Difficult thing, because Joe may think he's got kings or queens.
What have I done to deserve this? I have to call, James.
You got queens?
No, I've got aces.
You know. Aye, sweet. So if Joe gets beaten in this hand, it's going to be a bad beat. clear so far. Clear with a nine.
Just the river to come, and it's a king. It's a king. Hashim's been getting bashed up at this table. Anytime he's in a great situation, he seems to be getting bashed all about the place.
Oh, that's such bad luck. He played it, he played it as well as anybody could, and unfortunately he was kind of cold out. He was so far in front.
Well, he had the best pre-flop hand, but let's learn what beats what. Here in ascending order are the 10 possible poker hands, starting with the trash that you don't want to bet on. Then a pair, worth calling, depending on your poker face. Two pairs is better. But three of a kind beats him. Now you're talking a straight, a run of five consecutive cards in any suit. Better than that though, a flush, five cards, all of the same suit that don't have to run. A full house beats a flush, that's three of one number and two of another. Four of a kind, it does what it says in the tin. A straight flush, five cards suited and running. But nothing beats a royal flush, suited and running to the ace. That'll win every time. We're quite settled now on the TV table. The banter's died down slightly. Some serious poker being played.
What? The end of round two, the 15 minutes tournament break.
Right, brilliant. 15 minutes from the dinner break, John. In fact, after this hand on the TV table will close down. So at any stage you want to head off and get, I know you're very keen in your pie and chips, if you want to head off and get that.
But I do actually have to go and have a word with Thomas Kremser.
Thomas Kremser's our
tournament director.
Our man in the middle. Well, Hashim raises then, as I'm left all alone in the commentary box by old greedy guts. Ace 5 he's got unsuited, as John said earlier today before he nipped off to have his food. It's not a good hand to raise pre-flop in, because if it hit your ace, you're not sure where you are. But Balagard's going to call that with Queen Jack, and he's dominated by Corta Yeo, who's got Ace Queen. So four players in the pot now, five players in the pot, 18-year-old student Danny Show. Exactly the same hand as Yeo. We get two suited hands. Let's see if there's going to be any flush draws come off this flop. Well, none so far, but a couple of open-ended straights for Balagard and Jensen. Open-ended straight draws for them. And of course, it's Hashim who picks up the bottom pair with the fives. It could get checked at the turn. It's exactly what's happened. It comes over as a diamond. Balagard now in a flush draw as well as an open-ended straight. Hashim still leading, but he may not fancy it with that pair of fives and the nines on board. Jensen bets 1,000. Still five players competing his hands after the turn card. You don't see this often at this level. Hashim's got a good read there on Jensen. He calls that. He doesn't credit him for being on that nine or indeed on that 10. Decisions. Well, Balagard raises by another 1,000. Don't forget, he's actually on an open-ended straight flush draw. We've never had a straight flush in the EPT. We're in the second season. Could this be a first time? Two players left. That man Balagard with that straight flush draw. He'll take any diamond of any type. If Hashim allows him to even see that river card. A lot of gesticulating, huffing and puffing. He calls him. Quite a considerable pot total for this time of the day. Comes out two spades. We don't get our first straight flush. Pole position is Hashim. And Joe's checked that over. He knows Balagard doesn't have a nine. I think he read that fairly early on. He might have put him in the flush draw. But it'll be interesting. If Balagard wants to win this hand, he's going to have to make a big bet. He's checked it out. And Hashim's going to take it with just the fives and the nine on board with his ace kicker. And that's good news, because Joe's taking quite a few bad beats today in this TV table, and he'll like to get that in.
He already had.
That's the perfect appetizer for his dinner break. And taking him there is our man himself, John Duthie, patting the back. I think he's on a cut if Joe wins. Let's find out more about the World Series of Poker champion.
Rumour has it someone big is in town for the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. I'm going to go knock on their door. Hello, Joe Hashem.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm good.
I know you're preparing for the tournament and everything, but can we come in for a quick chat?
Okay.
Okay. To be a chiropractor?
I did.
Why did you stop?
I developed a condition in my hands that had nothing to do with my work. It was just an autoimmune condition, and it actually stopped me from using my hands. I struggled with it for 12 months, but during that time I was playing poker.
I see. So this is how it started?
Yeah, and so what happened at the end of the 12 months, my physician said to me, listen, kid, you know,
You're going to have to become a poker.
Yeah.
Wow, great.
Indirectly.
So tell us about the World Series 2005.
I actually asked my wife and I said to her, honey, would you mind if I go? You know, like, I'm not going to be able to take the family. And she just looked me square in the eyes like a really good poker player and said, no. But as it turned out, 2 weeks later, we're holidaying at the beach. And out of the blue, I don't know, she must have been touched by the hand of God or something that day. She turned around and said to me, like this, like you and I
Someone
sitting here.
Someone probably said 7.5. Something
happened. And she said, honey, why don't you go to Vegas with your friends for 2 weeks? And hey, you know, I did okay.
You did all right.
Yeah.
And you've really established yourself in poker. You walk in a room now, they know who you are.
Yeah,
I can't. People fear you now?
I think what happens is that a lot of the players have this respect for you, and they respect the accomplishment that that you've achieved. And some of them, not many, but some of them get a bit gnarly about it and like, oh yeah, big deal, so we're going to try and take him down, you know. But for the majority, it's a really nice respect and, yeah, it's good.
Thank you very much to Paul Yates for that interview. And in fact, let's again sweat with Joe. That's what we're going to do in this hand. The only card you'll see will be Joe Hashem's.
See if I can get it right this time.
We did get it right last time. You said it was all about the ace being in the other person's hand.
Okay, so Joe's raised 300 with pocket 8. So three times the big blind. We've got small blind 50, big blind 100. Okay, so...
So we're not going to see any other player's cards. Danny Shu has called.
Danny Shu's called.
One player up against Joe's pocket 8s at the moment.
And Jensen has called as well. Okay, so Joe's trying to think what they've got. So you've got to try and work out what these other players may have. They could have king, queen, they could have a pocket pair, they could have pocket tens. You know, ace-jack is a possible, I suppose.
And that's what he'd be worried about at the moment, of course, a six and a three. Well, fairly nothing cards.
Okay, so he's bet 1,200, a very strong bet, very strong bet. He's representing an overpair, aces, kings, queens. Okay, this will slow him down now. There's a call there from Jensen, which means that Jensen may have pocket queens.
Or a jack.
No, he could have pocket queens, pocket kings, or he could have ace jack. Or jack queen, possibly. Something like that. This is what's going through my mind. Now, Joe should check here, I think. He's not going to get away with it again. Okay, that's right. That's good play, that's good play.
Well, I need on the...
This is interesting.
Now, this is a terrible card for Joe because... I mean, there's jacks on board, he's got his eights in his hand. I mean, he knows if he's going up a jack of any type, he's in trouble.
Okay, so Jensen bets 1,500. Now, this is tricky because I think Joe knows he's lost this hand. Because there's no... 4-5 is the only possible hand that the guy could be calling with on the flop. So if he had 4-5 suited or something, 3-4-5-6, and he's put a bluff in on the end. So Joe's working the hand out, he's working it through in his mind what he's got. I don't think he's going to call.
Can't say that. I can't tell you that.
You can answer.
If I tell you the truth.
Yeah, you can tell me the truth. Whether you want me to call or not. Just can't tell me your cards.
Do what you like, Joe.
Why me?
I think he's going to call. I don't know, he might call the 1,500.
We've seen him call already in a situation where he thought he was behind, just to see what the other player had.
I'm going to say the guy's got ace-jack or he's got pocket queens, one or the other. Could have pocket kings. Oh, we're never going to know.
Well, there it is. Queen Jack, that was one of your calls?
Not quite. I said Ace Jack. But I may have said Queen Jack earlier on.
You
but
said every possible hand, John, in the game. 7-2 you started and worked your way up to Ace King. There you go, a nice sweat with Joe. We'll sweat with all the other players when we come back after this short break.
Leg of the EPT in Copenhagen. We have just walked into a blizzard and 288 players have walked into the casino behind me and are currently battling it out for that trophy, not to mention the prize money. But for some of them, the journey has been much longer than others.
That's right, because one of the features of the EPT is anyone can qualify at the touch of a button. It's our online qualification system. Anyone can log on to PokerStars.com and win your seat at an event. Just ask these two Canadian brothers. They'll tell you what it's all about.
What's your name?
My name's Don Protz.
What's your name?
My name's Doug Protz.
It's a blast being here. A little tired, it was a long flight over, but yeah, we're gonna have a lot of fun. I can't wait till it starts, and yeah, it's gonna be great. What do you do in your spare time?
I have to admit, I do play a lot of poker and maybe a little paragliding and work, but mostly poker online.
Probably play 5 or 6 times a week. For, I don't know, 3-4 hours a night on the weekends, a little bit more than that.
I typically play poker online at PokerStars.
It's a great site. It's well engineered. The support is awesome. Anytime you have questions, they're there to help you. There's lots of tournaments, lots of games. It's just all around a really good site. How did you first start in poker, Doug?
I think I started playing poker after watching it on TV, and you went online first and got me into it.
It's almost a problem-solving thing. It's a little puzzle you gotta figure out, and you gotta put it all together, put all the pieces together, and try to figure out your opponent. And there's so many different aspects of it that it's a lot of fun.
What's my most annoying habit?
Your most annoying habit, I think, is you go 100 miles an hour. You don't like to slow down. You like to be working all the time and doing something all the time. Who's the better out of us and why?
Well, you're looking at him. And why? Well, because, you know, what they say, a little bit more age has probably got a little bit more wisdom, and obviously I'm a little bit older, so I'm probably a little bit wiser, so.
Yeah, I don't buy any of that. Who do I think's the best poker player? I'd have to say Daniel Negreanu. I think he's a Canadian guy, so I kind of root for the Canadians.
I would have to say either Phil Ivey or Gus Hansen, in my opinion. Obviously, they have a huge, huge amount of talent, and they have a huge amount of skill, and they have a huge amount of balls.
So how are the brothers of the Felt doing? Well, Don, he played yesterday, and he'll be back for day 3. Doug is playing today under Don's watchful gaze, and so far he's doing all right. He's still there at least, which is more than can be said for Denmark's Martin Vallo out of the tournament. 91 players remain in day 2, and chip leader at this stage is Denmark's Chek Chi Hung with 48,000.
1-2-8.
Let's get back to the table. 150 for the big blind, small blind of 75. This is a featured TV table, they're no different than anyone playing out on the casino floor here in Copenhagen. We just want to feature them. Frode Fagerly then with pocket sevens.
Raises it up 225. Gets called by the pocket tens with Samson's hand.
Well, Samson so far playing more like Delilah. He hasn't had many cards whatsoever, but let's see if he can get a bit of nice action now.
Okay, so Joe calls. 325.
Why is he calling that with 7-5 offsuit?
Because the implied odds if he hits the perfect flop are very big. You can win a very big pot if you hit... the trouble is he doesn't know that Fagerly's got a pair of sevens, you know. If he hits 7-5, he's in deep trouble.
Well, there's the seven. Oh, there's the five, John.
Oh, dear.
So trip sevens for Fagerly. Very strong hand indeed. Samson's pocket tens not looking good at this stage. But let's just take a closer look at that, because Jensen has picked up the straight.
It's a huge possible hand, this. Absolutely massive.
A lot of outs for Fagerly, but at this stage he's got desperately unlucky. He's hit his trips. But as we just said, Hashim's got the two pair in the flop. He's going to fancy it. Samson's got the over pair. He's going to fancy it. And Jensen's hit the flop. He's hit the straight in the flop.
It's a potential massive hand, this. I think, yeah, I mean, Jensen's raised rightly, just in case there's a flush draw out there.
Yeah, you want to take care of that straight
or
away.
Trips, indeed, as well. He doesn't want somebody to... doesn't want the board to pair and then to get confused. Joe's in a real situation here. OK, so the pre-flop raiser has bet out under the gun and now has been re-raised by Jensen. So maybe he thinks, maybe my two pair aren't any good. Maybe this guy's got trip nines. Maybe he's got trip fives, trip sevens. Maybe I'm in trouble here. If he can throw this hand away, it would be very, very good laydown.
Also, of course, there is a possible straight draw there as well.
OK, now he's raising to see where he stands. Let's see how much he raises. OK, he's raised it 3,000. 2,700, to be exact.
Well, he is going to find out. Joe's going to find out that everyone has something. I think Samson's the one player that may just say thank you and good night at this stage of the hand, even with the overpair. He must sense that there's better out there.
I think he must know that he's losing.
Frode Fagerly calls him as trip sevens, as expected.
So Samson has gone. That's good.
Good fold.
OK, now, here we go. He's got to move in now. He's got to move in to get any flush draws out. If he just flat calls here, it's very dangerous. If a diamond comes or if the board pairs, he won't know what to do. He's got to make it too expensive for them to call. OK.
He's went all in.
Yeah, he's got to, it's the right move in this situation.
12,075 more than anyone's put in. Joe Hashim won exactly, look at his card, 7.5 million in the World Series of Poker. He's a very good player. He must know his two pair are not standing up at this precise moment. No decision, surely. Fagerly, on the other hand, he's got a decision. Hashim's drawn dead. We know this because Jez Bondo's thrown away one of the fives, and the only way Hashim can win this is to hit a five in the turn and a five in the river. There ain't two fives in the pack. And even if Hashim doesn't know that, he must sense that he's in serious trouble.
Oh, he does. He knows he's going to throw his hand away.
I fall under protest.
Yeah.
I want that noted.
He falls under protest. Well, he should be very happy.
Please tell me I made a good fold. He's got, come on.
Well, Fagerly's called. Yes. Fagerly has called with his trip sevens. You made a good call twice, sir, Joe, and this pot's no longer about you. Frode Fagerly with trip sevens needs to purr the board or hit another seven to get out of jail. Because Jensen has the straight. Oh, this is exciting poker. A two, a seven, a nine or a five, and Fagerly takes it. He's got loads of outs left in the pack, and that's not one of them, so it's the straight that does it for Jensen. Denmark beats Norway, he flops the straight. What an intriguing hand, four really big hands after the flop.
You see what I mean by what I was saying about sort of the kind of implied odds? The 6-8 looks like a really strange hand pre-flop, but if you hit your perfect flop, you can often get paid with it.
And that's exactly what happened. Really good hands. Really good hand.
Right, the blind's 100, 200 now. Very, very good hand. Very interesting. Great fold by Joe, actually, as well. You know, he found out where he was with the re-raise and folded. OK, here we go. Pocket threes. OK, so James Campbell just calls with his threes.
Jensen back in again. Pocket kings.
Okay, isn't that nice big pocket pair again? Well, he's definitely going to get called.
Balagard's, well, in all fairness, Kent Balagard doesn't have many chips in front of him, so pocket sevens may be the best thing he's hit in a while. So well, it's a good all-in raise.
No, exactly. It's costing him 300 a round. He's only got three rounds left, so he's going to get called here anyway, for sure.
We see the sevens again. Kent Balagard, from Denmark, 32 years old, an owner of a poker magazine. Well, he's not going to turn another page unless he hits a seven in his flop or gets lucky with a spade flush.
Yeah, he's not in good shape.
One out of five flops he's going to win. He's hoping it's going to be this one. Goes up against Joe Hashim's pocket kings.
I'm not sure Joe's won with his kings yet.
No,
what
I'm telling
you. What do you say about lucky spade flop? I mean, he's got...
Well, here it comes.
There's two of them.
Well, he still needs two more in his runner, runner spades. He's not going to get that now at all. The only thing that can save him is one of the two sevens that may be in this pack. And he hasn't hit it, so we got a casualty here. A player who's made a short trip to the casino, Copenhagen, and he'll be making the short trip home. Ken Fallegard goes out, and we're out for 2 minutes back after this break. Welcome back to Copenhagen and the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. Here is how it all works. The European Poker Tour is a no-limit Texas Hold'em tournament. No limit because you can bet all your chips at any time. Poker tournaments are elimination games which are played until one player has all the chips. The total prize fund is based on the number of entrants. The more players, the bigger the prize pool. On the EPT, this is typically divided amongst the top 27 finishers. In Monte Carlo last season, 27th place got €11,900, and the first EPT champion, Rob Hollink, got a staggering €650,000. And Rob Hollink is the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour champion. But let's get back to the start. The tournament begins with each player holding 10,000 chips. Players at numerous tables compete for one another's chips as the blinds and antes increase. Players eventually go all in.
I'm all in.
That decreases the total number of players left. As they leave the tournament, tables are broken. Players are reassigned to new tables in order to keep them full. Eventually, the last eight players left are assigned to the final table. Last man or woman standing or sitting wins.
You're right, I'm nearly 13,000 now, I'm waiting for the whack.
Yeah. Well, this is indeed our featured table. This is exactly where we stand at the moment as far as chips go. Well, Morten Jensen's up the top there with over 26,000, his name. Joe Hashem, World Series of Poker champion, over 16,000 chips, a very up and down day for him. And James Campbell's got a very good account of himself indeed. 13,000 chips on our TV table.
I'll be honest, Joe's made a great recovery because he went down quite a lot. He's played incredibly well to get back up to 16,000.
Now, as we were having a break, we had a bit of a short break. Some players not returned back to the table, but it's a long day, you got to remember. 8 hours at this TV table, they can go and have a pee when they want, they can go and get a drink when they want. So, not always a full bolt for every hand. Players will very much pick and choose the right moment to disappear for 5 minutes when they're not on a blind, when they're not in, not in any of the obvious raising positions.
Yeah, all the tables shrink down to eight-handed as well during the course of the first and second day here.
Now, Corti Yeo, we haven't seen much of. He's got the ace four, and we talked about Colin with an ace in that position. You're never sure where you are. Well, he's got a middle pin straight now. He'd be needing a two in that. Yep. The top pair to Fagerly, though, and the top pair also to Hashem. And he's got a better kicker.
Okay, and he bets out. He bets what looks like about 1,000. Yep, that's right.
Throw the bets out.
Joe will probably re-raise here, I suspect. Make it about 3,000.
Oh, he's asked him how much he has.
Yeah, it's a common tactic to try to get a read off a player is to ask somebody how much they have. Okay.
Another 1,500 on top of that. Kurt Yeo's going to have no part of that whatsoever. Fagerly raises all in. Hashem calls him. Well, it's interesting here. There are ways out, but he's really going to need to hit that 10. On the five, well, it's an interesting card. It purrs the board, which means anything now. Queens, kings, aces will all get him out of jail. And he doesn't get it, unfortunately. So it's nines and fives, and that jack kicker we talked about early on takes a hand for Hashem. And we lose Frode Fagerly. He turned up late. Well, he's leaving early, isn't he?
No jack kicker.
Goodbye, Frode.
Joe takes another one down.
Back to the Shire.
thinning out the crop.
Nice jacket, nice jacket. Well, Joe Hashem's been involved in almost every big hand we've had here today in the feature table. He likes to play poker, he likes to get involved, and he's a great reader of other players.
No, it's true, and he had his aces cracked very early on. A lot of players would really break, really lose it after that, and he's done really well getting back to where he is now. In a very strong position. Okay, so blind still, 100, 200. Okay, Joe's looking at king four, he throws it away. Okay.
Jez Bondo will take a look at his cards, talks a lot to Joe at this stage. Has been doing all day. Well, Jez makes a raise with ace king suited, another 700 if anyone wants to play with him.
Yeah, I doubt it. I doubt that people will, because he's not played that many hands. He's playing very, very solid poker, so you've got to figure he's got aces, kings, ace, king, queens, jacks, something like that.
Okay.
Ace, jack, throw that. I would throw that in the bin against this player immediately.
Well, Sean and Samson have a folded, and it's James Campbell who, I use the word loosely, boasts the ace, jack, and he's call with it, and he's being dominated at this stage.
Well, let's see what happens if he hits his ace,
He's in trouble if he hits the ace. He's certainly in a good situation if he can hit that jack. Well, here's exactly what John's been harping on about how important the card is that comes with your ace.
What do you mean harping on?
I mean that in a nice way. The aces came out here, but he doesn't have a leg to stand on at the moment.
No, exactly. And we didn't get filled up to that. Yeah. Okay, now Bondo's telling Gamble that I've got a better kicker than you.
That's exactly what that bet is doing.
Yeah. So he's saying, look, no, oh, he's called. You see, this is not only did he get into trouble calling pre-flop, now he's getting himself into more trouble. Now he's really in trouble. The only thing that Bondo could be scared of is a queen, which is possible. Let's see how Bondo bets here. Okay, he's bet 3,000, is it? 3,000, okay. Right, so now Campbell's thinking, he hasn't... Well, maybe I'm in trouble here, Maybe my hand isn't the best hand after all. Maybe he's got a queen. I think Campbell's completely misread this hand. I think he's made a mistake before the flop. He's made a mistake on the flop. And now he's gone...
All in.
Oh, he's gone all in. Now, this is the... he's either going to fold here or do exactly what he's done. And now Bondo may well say, Oh, he's got a queen. I'm in real trouble. Now he may throw his ace king away. I don't think Campbell's called to make this play, but I think the queen, he's kind of got lucky with this queen on the turn, and now he's trying to represent trips.
Well, it may be a bet too far for Jez Bondo, and it may be the only way Campbell can get out of this.
Oh, he's folded. Did he say fold or call?
I'm not sure. Ah, he's folded it out. And James Campbell says, you can show me your cards all you want, Jez. I ain't showing you what I had.
That was a very, very strong play. Very strong play.
Well, as you said, he didn't play the hand very well, but when he made his all-in call, and the problem was the two queens on board, and Jez Bondo wasn't willing to take that early bath.
My name is Jez Bondo, I'm 38 years old, and I'm from Copenhagen, Denmark. I was living in New York playing backgammon as a pro. Basically, internet poker started. And that was really nice because I could gamble from home. You know, I can put my feet up or do stuff like that. I think I'm good at reading persons. Pretty much I can tell when they're bluffing, who says I'm good at poker.
They're making it eight-handed.
What's that?
They're making it eight-handed.
Yeah, I know.
Well, you get Jasper Stolpe, who you've just seen a picture of. He's at the table from Denmark, another local player. Of all the EPT legs, Denmark's got the highest percentage of local players that come down and play. Massive sport here.
Huge in Scandinavia. This is one of the few places that you can play. Okay, Joe comes out raising. Ace four of diamonds. I like Joe's. I must say, I've never really watched Joe play poker, but I'd really like his style. He's very aggressive. He finds out where he is. Very, very interesting player. Okay, so Yo has re-raised with his pocket queens.
I think that might be Yeo, John.
Is it Yeo?
Yeah.
Yeo.
Rather than Yo.
Yeah. Yeo. Okay, that's. Let's see. So Joe's thinking now. He's not going to call this. Is he?
He's got enough chips.
I got that right.
But he's calling it because, as you say, the ace is no good to him, really. But if they were to be diamonds in the flop, he'd be in a great situation.
Well, he can also, the other thing, of course, is he can also outplay his opponent on the flop here. So he can either represent the king or the heart. You know, now if he bets, he can represent the king because he knows the other guy hasn't got a king.
Hearts is also a worry for Yeo at this stage, but he's got such a short stack, John, that it's going to be very hard to bluff Yeo off this hand with such a big pocket pair.
Yeah, well, that's one of the problems, you see. I think if Joe had seen how few chips he had beforehand, he probably wouldn't have called with the ace four of diamonds.
Well, let's see exactly what happens. Hashim has made the bet.
I think I'm dead. I'm going to call anyway.
Nah, you're not dead. Just can't fold the hand. Your points.
Yeah.
Show me nice.
Well, Joe's called Yeo's hand. It was only a few extra chips for Hashim to put in to match Yeo's all-in raise.
It's interesting. I mean, he's called his hand. He knows he's got queens, but he thinks he may just still be able to fold them. He got it wrong, unfortunately.
Well, such a short stack for Yeo, he's now doubled it. Well, the hand pretty much played itself. Get Yeo all in was the situation we were in there, and it wasn't a great bet. Lost a few chips out of it, but at this stage, I suppose you pay your money, you take your chances.
I think he's made a reasonable move there. He's trying to represent the king, and if Yeo's got anything less than the pocket queens, then he probably can't call there. We've seen some interesting play from Joe Hashim so far. You know, he's amassed quite a nice stack of chips. He varies his play. I quite like his style. He's a very good character too. You know, he's a nice bloke.
Well, you can afford to lose a few. We'll keep an eye on him as the tournament progresses. But let's introduce you to some fresh faces and indeed a new feature table. Right, here's our new players in the feature table. Torgeir Copperud is in seat one. All easy to pronounce here. Morten Jr. in C2 from Denmark. Leah Greve, one of many female players playing here today. She's in C3. Anina Gundersen, talked about her earlier. She's in C4. In C5, it's Klaus Heroda Rasmussen. In C6, Brian Clausen. And in seat 7, just rejoice that he's not Danish, Ramfaswani. And making up the table, well, back to Denmark we go. It's Jeppe Mikkelsen, so 6 Danish players, 1 English player and a Norwegian at our new feature table. Copperud in seat 1 from Norway, seat 7, Ramfaswani from England, everyone else Danish. A nice mix of players here, male and female.
Yeah, it's very good to see some Danish women players. And Anina Gundersen has got ace 4. Let's see how she plays it. Okay, that's a sensible pass.
Anina and I are going out for a drink later, John, if you'd like me to get Leah to come along. We get double date.
Oh, God. You're just full of it.
We give a game of strip poker.
Here comes Ram out betting Jack 6 of clubs, as is his way. Always likes to command a table, Ram. Okay, so
3-5 of diamonds on the big blind, and Junior's going to make that small call and have a look and see, does the flop bring him anything? Well, it hasn't done that at all. Faswani hits second highest pair. Junior checks. Let's see if Faswani thinks he's being trapped or indeed has the winning hand as it stands after the flop. Well, he's certainly put a bet out there to see where he stands. 1500. And it's a fold from Junior. So a nice easy hand, the first at our feature table. Faswani wins it, 6 Danish, 1 Norwegian, but it's Englishman that comes out on top. We're back after the break. More from Copenhagen on our new feature table. Welcome back to the EPT in Copenhagen. This is our new featured table. We've introduced you to the players, so let's see some poker. The Antis, 25, everyone puts that in. Small blind, 150, working up that big blind of 300. Let's see if cards are being dealt out. See what type of action we're going to get. Well,
an early race from Morten Jr., 28 years old, from Randers in Denmark, versus a car mechanic.
Nice race with 5-7 suited. I like that. Been called?
Well, he's been called by King Jack suited.
Let's hope the hearts don't come.
By Klaus Schroeder Rasmussen, who prefers to play Omaha high-low.
Okay, Rams called.
His ace three, not going to know where he is if the ace comes out.
Okay, so Rams on the button. Likes to call. See where he stands.
So flop comes out. Well, we've got one heart on there in terms of relating it indeed to the flush draws. Junior has hit second pair.
Okay, so both checked to Ram. Bets 1,500. Just called there. See if he hits, can hit his second pair.
He's worried about the queen, and that's why he's just called that. Morten Jr. still works full time, and his biggest win, $10,000.
Wow, good bet by Ram, 3,000.
Well, this will probably be the experience of the Hendon Mob Man over a relatively new player.
Yeah, he's putting out a false tell there as well, Ram. That's quite nice. He gave a little bit of a swallow.
Well, Morten Jr. likes table tennis and fishing, and I'm afraid he was the fish that time himself. He knows all about Ram Vaswani now, and here's some information for you.
Ram Vaswani from Mill Hill, London, and I'm age 36. I think it's like any sport you play, you know, you've got to be fearless. When the pressure's on, you've got to keep calm, make decisions based on the knowledge of the game, not to be scared in any situations. Holly, my little girl, she's 3.5 months old. Now I'm up all night changing nappies.
I don't believe that somehow.
Ram Vaswani is an excellent poker player, one of the best in the EPT in its two seasons. If you ask me, I go out on a limb. He's a great reader of other players. He likes action maybe a bit too much. That could be his one flaw. Likes to be involved in every pot.
Yeah, he's a great... I mean, he was second here in Copenhagen last year. He won in Dublin. You know, he's a phenomenal player, Ram.
And a quick thinker. He's done very well indeed in speed poker tournaments as well. In fact, he's world speed poker champion. Mickelson hits the ladies. Lea Greve calls.
Yeah. She's not been playing very long, I don't think, Lea. Somebody told me she actually had the hand rankings on a little piece of paper on her knee just to remind herself.
Yeah, she qualified on she qualified on Poker Stars a month ago. It goes to show anyone could be living the dream.
That can happen.
I hope she flops three tens. Well, she doesn't. Lea Greve then will consult a bit of paper in her knee and it'll tell her she's got diddly squat. Mickelson bets with the overpair, only worried about a four. She can't call, there's absolutely no way she can call.
She may move all in. She may use her image to bluff him off, but there's no way he's going to fold. Because he knows she hasn't got aces or kings. The only possible hand she may have is like... a house full of nines.
She's raised all in and she's going to get called because Mickelson has the overpair. And it's going to be good enough for him. Unless Lea Greve can hit that ace. She's still got some chips in front of her, Lea, so she's going to be okay. But as we said, she needs an ace in the river. Mickelson will want to see that. And it's Mickelson who doubles up. Greve still got some chips in front of her. Go easy on her, Mickelson! That's someone's grandmother.
I don't think she likes being... I'm not sure that she likes being on the feature table. Maybe she just wants to go now. An interesting hand. Well, he's happy because he's picked up a few more chips.
Certainly good. A modest stack in front of them's just been doubled. Never bad at this stage of the tournament. And any big multi-table, there's a lot of players playing at the moment and you want to have... above chip average is a great situation to be in. Well, the big blinds now went up to 400, 200 for the small blinds, plus the antes means a pot total of 1,000 before anything happens. And Ram Vaswani from England, part of the famous and, well, infamous Hendon Mob, he puts the raise in then.
Oh, ace five, he'll probably get called. I think she thinks any hand with an ace in is quite big, so.
Leia Grave, she does. She's all in for 2,500 for Swanee. If Swanee had 2-7 off Sukma's bluffing, he'd still put the extra chips in here. They have two live cards. Will the woman who's been playing for a month go up against the power of Ram for Swanee? Lyson calls with 10-9 offsuit. Quite a lot of chips to call that.
So both players will probably check it out to knock the other player out. Okay, he's picked up a middle pin straight draw, Clausen. He's an 8 for a straight, in other words.
This nobody is anything.
Ram is betting with absolutely nothing into no side pot. So he'll take down. Yeah, he's knocking out the other player. Who would have loved to have stayed in for nothing. At this stage of the tournament, to be honest, knocking players out, whilst significant, is not that important.
And how can they do it to Leia? Princess Leia, 2 cards away from leaving the casino Copenhagen.
Oh, now Ram is winning.
The queen's been hit. 2 pair for Ram for Swanee. She didn't want to see a queen or a king in the turn of the river. It's exactly what she saw. Put your notes away there. Leia Grave says goodbye. Only been playing for 4 weeks, but Poker Stars has made her dream come true. Back to last of the summer wine and a nice cup of tea. Well, that's it from her featured table. So let's hear from its latest loser.
So you'd be knocked out of the tournament tonight, but it almost doesn't matter because this is the start of an exciting journey for you, isn't it?
Yeah, I want to play more poker.
Well, I'm sure you will, and I'm sure you'll be a real inspiration to all the other ladies out there thinking about. So what advice would you give them?
They're not enough ladies.
What would you tell the ladies at home thinking about playing poker?
Get out and play poker. It's so much fun.
Great. She's an inspiration to us all.
Oh, well, that's Leia out. But we see every tournament we do now and every leg of the European Poker Tour, more women come into the sport.
Yeah, I mean, they're following in the footsteps of some formidable American players like Annie Duke, Jennifer Harmon, Kathy Liebert.
Isabel Mercia.
Isabel,
of course.
Of her
Isabel
and as well.
Yacht,
yeah.
Sailing into the distance, John.
One of the more attractive of the players.
You said some of them aren't attractive.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm going to get myself in some very deep water. But the thing is, a lot of these girls and women are playing online, qualifying for satellites on PokerStars and other online sites, and they're coming to the European Poker Tour, and they're making a huge impression. I mean, they can be very intimidating when you're playing against. Isabel's a very intimidating player. I've played against her a couple of times, and she's very, very, very good, capable.
Who's doing the dishes, though? 50 people went through from day one. We finished on our feature table for now, but other games still going on about the casino. Let's find out who from day two is going to make it to the final day. The end of day two was fast approaching here in Casino Copenhagen, and what everyone wants to know is who will be back for day three. Will Doug Protz, our Canadian online qualifier, chanced his arm not once but twice and doubled up both times? He'll go through to tomorrow. Joe Hashem has been chancing his arm all day. Seems the World Series of Poker champion can't stay away from trouble in Denmark. And it was in the small hours of the morning. He goes all in against Jasper Stolpe. And goes out. It's a long way to come from Australia for one day's play, but Joe's certainly been good value.
Thank you for playing.
It was inevitable the way I was going today. I just had a really up and down day. Every time I got my nose in front, I got smacked and went backwards. So in the end, I decided that I wasn't going to come back tomorrow short stacked. I was either going to build some chips or go home and get some sleep, because I'm pretty tired at the moment. But it was a great tournament. Actually, I enjoyed it a lot.
At the end of day two, 97 players had been eliminated, leaving 47 to go forward to the next day. And top of the chip counts are Holland's Mark Naldon with 120,000 in front of him. Big stack, that's England's Ram for Swanee. We've seen earlier 72,000 chips. And Denmark's Czech Shi Hung has 66,000. They're all coming back for day three. Make sure you do too.
So it's
Good night.
Good night from Casino Copenhagen, but it's definitely not...
Farewell.
Farewell, as we still have two more days left of world-class poker action. We'll see you next time. In the meantime, all this poker talk has got me in the mood. I'm going to go see if my poker face is up to scratch. I think it is. Bye.